Pastor Chum.
Well, Pastor Chum is going up. Just to tell you, I got a WhatsApp from Geraldine Yaze this morning, the second child of Gordon and Esther Yaze. And Jerry Yaze landed up in hospital yesterday. He fell and he broke his L2 vertebrae. And they don't know why he fell. They've ordered a brain scan. The blood work is fine. So they've ordered a brain scan. So she just said, his spirits are good, but she said, please pray for him. So I said, we'll be praying here.
You want us to take a moment to pray for Jerry? Yes.
I should have done it before opening prayer, sorry.
That's fine. Why don't we do that? Harris, you want to lead us?
Sure. Loving Lord, Father in heaven, we just want to linger in prayer in your presence this morning. We want to lift up Jerry Yaze to you and his family this morning, and we know that your healing presence is there, and we just pray that his recovery will be complete. Guide the doctors and those who are assessing his condition, and we look forward, dear God, to your redemptive and restoring hand upon him today. Thank you for the worldwide circle of prayer, and that you are there ministering to his need. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I will project my experience having grown up at Solusi to those who grew up at Bethel.
Yes.
And I want to, this morning, to suggest that those institutions allowed us to grow, to learn, to embrace as part of our life, a life of trust in God, a life of praise of God, and a life of hope in God.
Yes.
And when you live and work with people who have no trust in a God, when you live and work with people who have no hope, when you live and work with people who have no praise in their mouth, then you realize that the mission work, the Adventist work, as it affected natives like me in giving us hope. And I have looked at that and also thought to myself, what would it have been if South Africa had been colonized by China or by India or maybe by the Arab nations? We probably would be Muslims, maybe believers in Shinto or Hindu or Buddha. But for some reason, behind the scenes, God orchestrates His will in our life. And we were colonized by the Western world and introduced to Christianity. And in particular, for us, we were introduced to a special brand of Christianity, the Seventh-day Adventist brand. And I've talked to some of my friends who have said, you know, Mark, even if you don't make it to heaven, the lifestyle that you have learnt and lived through life has actually been a good trade-off in terms of the quality of life that I've experienced. And I want to say that it is because of that that I appreciate the missionaries who came and brought Jesus Christ into our communities. And in particular, for those of us who were affected by the Seventh-day Adventist faith. And in particular, for those of us who benefited from our fathers being workers in the Adventist Church. And I was talking to a fellow in Kenya one time, and he said to me, you know what, Mark, you guys really cheated us, because pastors' children had the advantage of speaking in English in the home. You prayed for food in English, and you had contacts. And comparatively in numbers, there is more of Adventist pastors or workers' children who moved to the States than just ordinary members who were on the pews. And truly, I must admit, we were advantaged by that. But more than that, Peters wrote the book, His Study Out of Zambia, and he established the fact that our upward mobility around Adventist areas has been much higher than other areas all over Africa. And you know, when I reflect on that, it becomes very clear to me that we as Seventh-day Adventists, we as products of Bethel College, have a reason to praise God. Secondly, we have a reason to trust God.
Yes.
We have a reason to hope in the second coming of Christ.
Amen.
And when I put those together, I found myself reflecting on Psalm number 71, a passage that was written by David when he turned 60.
Amen.
He could write and say, "In God I trust."
Amen.
Because this is a fellow who had fought with the lion and conquered it. And when you were at Bethel at a time when there was no rain, and you prayed for rain, and you saw the rain fall in response to your prayer, then you have a reason to trust him.
Amen.
And to your word, Elder Paris, yesterday, then you can only fear for the future. As you forget those experiences that in your formative socialization, you saw God at work in your life in that institution. And therefore, even as David is turning 60, he says it is a privilege to turn 60 knowing that I have a God who I can trust.
Amen.
And then, of course, I was working in the mobile home industry, and one time I was walking into the plant and I saw three of these guys rush out of a small building and they were painting. And as I walked towards this place, I asked these fellows, why are you running away? They said, man, there's a fire, don't go in. And I'd been in that building several times and I knew there were three fire extinguishers inside there. And rather than argue with them in terms of, well, why did you just pick up an extinguisher? And I just walked into the building, picked up the fire extinguisher and extinguished the fire. I could only do that because I knew that there was an extinguisher bigger than the fire in the building. And I want to say that places, Christianity, like we have been taught, has allowed us that when fires do come into our life, they will come. When others actually have no way to go, and when they are running away and trying to understand. For me, my brothers who did not embrace it, they actually to this day say, no, things are not going well for us because you're not worshiping the ancestors. If you joined with us, things will be okay. I say, listen, for me, when the fire begins, the extinguisher is my God.
Yes.
And I say that David summarizes this so well. And then we look at life and we say, how do we handle it? And so often I find myself coming back and rephrasing John 14, don't be stressed. You know, Jesus says, don't let your heart be troubled. He simply says, don't be stressed. I am with you. And David simply says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Of who shall I be afraid? Except for that ethic, for that teaching, for that Christianity that Bethel shared with South Africa and beyond. For that Adventist missionary who saw the vision and brought it to our communities. Today we would be a people, maybe, without the quality of trust, of faith, and of praise. And I want to say that as we meet this evening, this weekend, may we enjoy the benefits, appropriate them, embrace them. And as we reflect on the vision for Bethel, maybe generations yet to come need to be blessed by what has blessed us already.
Yeah.
And I close with the story of the young 9-year-old girl who came to Imala and said, Mom, tell us, what is our history? Where do we come from? And the mom says, we came from Adam. God made Adam and Eve, and then out of them came all people of the world, and that's my ancestry. And later that day, the little girl went back to the father and asked the father, and the father says, daughter, I said, yeah, you are smart. I know you've been to school. You see, Darwin says we came out of small cells and we evolved and we became monkeys, and then with time we became human beings. And then in the evening, later before the child died, mom came to tuck the baby in and said, the little baby looked at the mom and said, Mom, I'm a little confused. When I asked you about ancestry, you said we came from Adam. But when I asked Dad where we came from, he says we came from monkeys. So which is which? And mom, in her smart diplomacy, simply said, listen, you asked me about my ancestry, where I came from, and I told you. You asked your dad, and he told you. All I'm saying, dear friends, is today, as a Seventh-day Adventist Christian, I've come to a point where really it does not bother me. All I'm happy for is if you ask me, I know that I believe in a God who is coming again, a God who I can trust, a God whom I can praise, a God who can hope for that one day soon, even in my old age, above 60, I still know that he shall come, and the trumpet shall sound, and the dead in Christ shall arise, and we who are alive will be caught up into glory to be with the Lord forevermore. And as we interact with the Holy Spirit and with one another this weekend, may we please once again enjoy what we already have, that spirit of trusting a God that we know and we've walked with.
Amen.
May we find it in our mouth to praise that God who has accompanied us and blessed us through the years. Mm-hmm. And may we put our solid hope in Him, because He is our God.
Amen.
Shall we bow our heads for prayer? We'd like to thank you, Lord, once more for this reminder that whenever we're facing challenges and troubles, you're there and ready to help. And you've proven yourself in the past. All of us can attest to what you've achieved in our lives. I think when we look back and think back to our days at Bethel, we never imagined that you'd lead us this far. Actually, folks around us never imagined you'd lead us this far. And we thank you, Lord, for what you've achieved in our lives. And as we think back to Bethel, we know there are still kids there. We don't know what the future holds. And we ask, Lord, that you may use us to bring some courage, some hope, and resources to help those kids achieve their goals. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.